Hi, I'm Susan Taylor with Scripps Health in San Diego, California. Please subscribe to our Scripps Health YouTube channel. We've got great videos featuring the latest technology, our stellar doctors, and inspiring patient stories. Each year, roughly 300,000 people in the U.S. need to have a heart valve replaced because of what's called stenosis. It's a narrowing of the aortic valve, which affects blood flow. If left untreated, this can lead to heart failure. In the past, the only way to treat this condition was through major open heart surgery, cutting the chest open. But a lot of patients can't handle that kind of open heart surgery. Enter TAVR, transcatheter aortic valve replacement. That's a mouthful. Back in 2007, Scripps was involved in a nationwide clinical trial testing out a new way to replace that failing aortic valve without cutting the chest open. And the doctor who took part in that clinical trial joins us, Dr. Paul Tierstein, Chief of Cardiology at Scripps Clinic in La Jolla, California, and Medical Director of the Prebys Cardiovascular Institute. Thanks so much for being with us, Dr. Tierstein.
Hello, happy to be here.
Let's start with the basics. Talk about the aortic valve. What is it and how does it work?
Well, when the heart pumps blood around the body and the heart squeezes, the blood comes out of the heart and then the heart relaxes. We don't want the blood to come back into the heart, so the valve shuts, and the blood then carries down through the rest of the body. But it's a really important valve. It's the main valve in the heart muscle.
So it allows the blood to keep flowing and not come back this way.
Exactly. It makes it go forward. It's supposed to come back.
And so what can go wrong with it?
Well, it can be create a lot of problems. The most common is in elderly patients, usually 70, 80 years old, occasionally in their 60s, where the valve really becomes worn out and becomes calcified. And now it no longer opens well or closes well. Most commonly, it doesn't open all the way. And it slowly starts to become sort of like a rusty valve. And it opens maybe halfway, and the patient may feel a little short of breath. But then over time, you know, 5, 10 years, it's opening minimally. And maybe by the time it's only opening 20%, imagine a door opening 20% and everyone trying to get out of the room. It gets very hard for the blood to leave the heart. The heart gets enlarged and the patient feels generally very short of breath.
Now, is that aortic stenosis what
you're
talking
about? It's called aortic stenosis.
Okay. And how many people age, what is it, what's the average after age 85 of people getting this?
Well, it starts in the 70s and 80s. By the time you get to the 80s, in this country, you know, almost 10% of patients have this problem.
Really?
So it's really a prevalent problem. It's a very common problem.
So in the past, you've treated it with this open heart surgery where you have to cut the chest open, but what's the percentage of people who really can't handle that?
There is a lot of patients that have trouble, particularly since it's a disease of elderly patients. We have a lot of patients that show up for the first time when they're 95. Obviously, that's going to be a hard thing for a patient to go through. But even for a young patient, it's no fun to have your chest opened up and then the heart opened and then a valve sewn into it. So what a surgeon does is open up the heart and actually take out the valve and then put a new valve in and put about 20 sutures around it to hold it nice and tight and then put everything back together. Obviously, that's a pretty big procedure, and there's a long recovery time. With TAVR, it's much simpler. We put the valve in through an artery in the leg, generally. That leg artery is not big enough. We can find alternative ways to get it in, but usually it's an artery in the leg, and we just pass it up into the functioning valve or the deteriorating valve, and we implant it either by blowing a balloon up. And the valve the valve is attached to a frame, or by unsheathing a self-expanding frame, the new valve goes right inside the old valve, and starts working right away. It pushes the old valve aside.
I was going to say, what happens to the old valve?
Yeah, that's a tough one for people to understand, and it was a tough one for us to understand initially. But the old valve just gets pushed aside, and the new valve starts working right away. It's important to put it in the right place. But we're very careful about that.
And how do you maneuver it up through, you know, the leg and then put it right in the right place?
So we have x-rays, and the patient is lying on the table, and we can actually look at their heart through the x-rays and see that the valve is positioned perfectly. And when we have it exactly where we want it, we either inflate a balloon or we unsheath it, depending on the valve that we're using, and deploy it in the correct place. The old valve is just pushed aside. The new one starts working right away. And the whole thing happens very, very quickly.
How long does the procedure take?
Well, the patient takes about an hour to get on the table and draped and all set. But then once we start, it's really about a 45-minute procedure. And of course, the patient doesn't have any, there's no incision, there's no scalpel used. It's just a little needle hole in the artery of the leg, so the recovery is basically zero. The patient stays in the hospital one night. They wake up right away. We don't even put them fully to sleep. Now, we don't usually put a breathing tube in. They're not intubated. So they awake pretty much right away, and they have lunch. The next morning, they get up and walk around. We look at their heart again with a sonogram, make sure everything's okay, and they're usually out by noon. We even had one patient go home the same day. So the recovery is very minimal, and that's what really the benefit of it.
And compare this to traditional open heart surgery to replace that aortic valve.
Well, traditional open heart surgery, the main problem is the recovery, because you have to open the chest, saw through the breastbone. So of course, recovering from that takes a while. So you're usually in the hospital 4 or 5 days, and when you get home, you're not driving for weeks, and you're not really going back to work right away. There's a long recovery process. Of course, at the end of the recovery, in a couple of months, the patients who have open chest surgery do really well, generally. So it's just that recovery period that's so hard, and TAVR avoids that, and that's its big benefit.
Because this is so much less invasive for the body.
Yeah, much less invasive, much less time in the hospital, usually one night, much quicker time to recovery and walking around. Usually you can walk right away, you can drive the next day. I've met patients out to dinner the next night. A 94-year-old patient of mine got married a couple of months later. So they really resume their life. And one of the things that I've noticed is the patients feel about 10 years younger. On the average.
So you say it really does, it turns the clock back.
Yeah, it really is. More than almost anything else I've done in medicine in my career, this is transformative to patients' lives. They are, for the most part, not all of them, but I would say about 80% are so grateful because they can breathe again. And they really get their lives back, and they're the way they were 10 years earlier. It doesn't solve all their medical problems, obviously, but it is a big, big event in their life.
You're talking about patients. I need to tell you that patients come from all over the world to be treated by Dr. Tierstein. And we want you to hold this thought because we're going to come back to this. In a couple of minutes, we're going to tell you about one of Dr. Tierstein's very special patients. Can you guess who it is? We'll give you a hint. Her initials are MT. MT. Hold that thought. We'll come back to it in just a little bit. How long does the TAVR last, Dr. Tierstein, once you put a new one in? Is that it for the rest of your life?
Currently, we really only have data on a large number of patients out to about 5 or 6 years. So at 5 or 6 years, we know it's doing at least as well as the surgically implanted valve that requires opening the chest. So we assume 10 to 15 years later, we'll have to do it again. But the really cool thing is that we can do the same thing again and put a new valve inside the old valve that we placed. So the procedure is exactly the same, and in some ways it's even easier to put a second valve in. So we can really avoid the need for major open heart surgery.
How many TAVR procedures have been performed at Scripps, roughly?
We're just at 2,000 now. So and it's become a very common procedure. We're doing upwards of 400 a year, and it's really actually been a big deal for the hospital. We've had to change a lot of the way we do things and schedule things because it's become now one of our most common procedures.
And talk about the collaborative, specialized TAVR team. I think it underscores Scripps' approach to this kind of comprehensive, specialized patient care.
You know, we always get better outcomes if we work together as a team. It's two heads, three heads, four heads are way better than one. So the way we do these procedures is first when we look at the patients and evaluate them to make sure they're good candidates, we work together. I'm a cardiologist. I work with at least one surgeon. It's actually a whole team of surgeons and a whole team of cardiologists. And then we have wonderful nurse practitioners, nurses, catheterization laboratory technicians. I mean, really phenomenal people. And we bang our heads together to make sure we're doing the right thing for the patient. Then when it comes time to do the procedure, we work as a team, the surgeon, the cardiologist like myself, anesthesiologist, an imager, an echocardiographer is often involved. We call it the heart team, and it's become a very essential part to our success.
It's very complex, and it's very high tech, and it's a very well choreographed dance that you all do.
Good way of putting it. It is a dance, and I think we all work really well together. And it's happening not just with the aortic valve. Now it's extending to the mitral valve, to other valves and other structural. Instead of opening the chest, we're able to do with catheters a lot of what we had to do before by opening the chest.
Is there anybody who can't have the TAVR procedure?
So I was thinking about that. Very few. So for example, the valve comes in certain sizes. And very rarely a patient is too big and needs to go to the big and tall shop for the valve, and they haven't built that one yet. That's very, very rarely. More commonly, and it's still rare, but a more common reason not to get the valve replaced with a TAVR might be that you have something else wrong with your heart, another valve that we can't help you with a catheter and we need to open up your chest for, or you have an aneurysm of the aorta, a swelling of the aorta that ought to be replaced at the same time. And so that requires, at this point, still opening the chest. So there are some patients we have to turn down, but it's now becoming increasingly rare.
What about patients who have bleeding problems or pre-existing kidney disease?
It's a good question. So pre-existing kidney disease is always a problem for any kind of procedure. And we have to use some dye contrast for these procedures. So that is hard on the kidneys. We've gotten very good at limiting the amount of dye we use, and we're actually really specialized at that at Scripps. We can do these procedures with a very minimal, in fact, we've done a few with no dye, which puts very little stress on the kidneys. Open heart surgery puts actually more stress on the kidneys. That's a big thing for the kidneys to go through. So TAVR is usually better for a patient with impaired kidneys. Bleeding problems can be a problem for either procedure. Usually bleeding is worse for an open procedure. Obviously, there's a lot more bleeding involved, need for blood transfusion. Bleeding can be a problem for the TAVR. It's something we watch really closely, and we make sure that we minimize it as much as possible.
Are there any drawbacks to the TAVR procedure?
So the risks of the procedure, I usually tell the patients, is about a 5% chance that something will go badly, about a 1% chance of death, about a 2% chance of major stroke. And that, of course, is what everyone is most concerned about. And it's a really serious thing when it happens. And about a 3% chance of bleeding. So all in all, about 5% of the patients have complications. It's not perfect, but 95% of the patients do phenomenally well.
All right, so let's come back to this. People from all over the world come to be treated by you. But you had one very special patient who is someone really that everybody knew. Tell us what happened back in 1991 with a woman who had the initials MT.
So Mother Teresa was in Mexico, in Tijuana, at one of her missions, and she developed a pneumonia and a heart attack and was sent to Scripps, and we got
she
to take care
of her. She was secretly whisked in.
Yeah. One of my students actually who went back to Tijuana, came to Tijuana to learn, Dr. Abinal, saw her in Tijuana and sent her up. That's how we came to take care of her.
And this was not a TAVR procedure. What was wrong with her?
So she had a pneumonia, and so she needed antibiotics and care for her lungs, and she also had a heart attack, so she needed an angiogram, and we did that. And
what's an angiogram?
That's when we put a catheter into the arteries that feed the heart and look at them and see if there's any blockages. And so she had cholesterol buildup in all three of her vessels, and we treated them with what we had then, which is a balloon. We just stretched them. But one of them, her most important artery, did not come out so well with a balloon. And so fortunately at the time we were also investigating the stent, which is now the routine way we treat this. And a stent is a little metal scaffold that you can insert. It's wrapped on a balloon and then inflated into the area of blockage, and it remains in there. You deflate the balloon, remove the balloon, the stent stays put and holds the artery open. So we did that with Mother Teresa's artery, and it stabilized it fine and really worked beautifully. So it was in some way related to the TAVR in that it was an investigational procedure we were lucky to be doing at the time that Mother Teresa came, and we had access to it, so we used it, just like we treat some of our TAVR patients with investigational valves.
And it became a sacred stent?
Well, she blessed it. She was in the hospital for a month, and it was really wonderful taking care of her. And I got to go to Calcutta afterwards and visit with her. But she was really a special part of my career, my life. And she did bless the stent. We called it the sacred stent.
And you hold up just fine under pressure. You are unflappable, which is exactly what you want when you want someone operating on your heart. But when you heard that the Pope was praying for you during the surgery.
Yeah, I mean, I knew she was very special and a special VIP, but what got my attention was when I went out to talk to the sisters, and I told her everything went well. We had a little problem, but we were able to stabilize it with this new investigational stent. They told me that the Pope had my name and was praying for me during the procedure, which I thought was, that really got my attention. Yeah,
I would imagine. Yeah. And she lived another, how many years?
8 years.
And she was able to continue her humanitarian work.
I visited her in Calcutta and saw what she was doing. It's pretty amazing, man.
It's phenomenal. But it speaks volumes to what you do and what's being done here at Scripps. Let's go back to the TAVR procedure. Up until recently, this was only available for high-risk patients. Those were patients who were too ill to undergo the open-heart surgery. Now it's being expanded to a much wider population, to low-risk patients?
Yes, so we've done studies, and these are randomized studies, really, where a computer flips a coin, and half the patients get open-chest surgery, and half the patients get the TAVR procedure, and those studies have been completed now. The TAVR outdid the open-chest procedure, hands down. I mean, there was less time in the hospital, much quicker recovery, less stroke, better outcomes. We have data out now to 3 years, and the TAVR is doing better in the low-risk patients than the open procedure. I believe it will be the usual way we treat patients with aortic stenosis in the future.
So when you look down the road, what do you see?
I see a lot of new incredible medical advances. We are all really lucky to be living in this era where there are technological improvements. They are really helping patients, not just with TAVR, but as with everything to do with your heart and then some. But certainly with respect to the heart, we're replacing a lot of the major open chest procedures with procedures we could do through a little catheter in the leg artery or leg vein.
Which is so great for the patient because it's less invasive, it's faster healing time, you're up and moving back to moving at the speed of your life.
Yeah, we're really lucky. I think the patients are lucky, and we're all lucky because we'll all be patients. We're all living longer, partly because of this technology, and these are our tools and that will be really helpful to so many patients.
Any final thoughts, Dr. Tierstein?
I think we should be happy to be alive today. With so much opportunity for health, both preventative and also secondary treatment when we have problems. And we should be really happy for the technology. It is really important for our lives.
Thanks so much, Dr. Tierstein. Thousands of Scripps patients have successfully been treated with the TAVR procedure, as we said, and Scripps is repeatedly ranked by U.S. News & World Report as one of the best in the nation for heart care. If you want more information on the TAVR procedure, just click on the link or go to scripps.org/videos. Want more critical information about your health? We take care of you from head to toe. Please subscribe to our Scripps Health YouTube channel and follow us on social media at Scripps Health. I'm Susan Taylor. Thanks so much for joining us. It's our mission at Scripps to help you heal, enhance, even save your life.